Keeping up with the motto, let learning be a joy and teaching a pleasure. Here we are with the remote teaching and learning process to bridge the gap. Happy learning, students. Whenever we hear the word gift, only the materialistic and worldly things come to our minds. Never do we ever try to think in a different direction, that of all the gifts, the most valuable and meaningful are the abstract feelings, qualities, values, time, and the people who are our loved and near ones. The greatest gift you can ever own is not found in the shops or under your Christmas tree. It is found in the hearts of your loving family and true friends. The best gifts in life are not things. TVM welcomes all the students of class 10 for this English prose session, and we are going to know more about gift and the art of gifting through the chapter, The Gift of the Magi. Written by the famous writer William Sidney Potter, better known as O. Henry, that is his pen name, born in Greensboro, North Carolina. Said to be as master of surprise endings, where the plot is twisted and the ending turns out differently than expected. He's known for his writing about ordinary people and also for his play of words. Few of his famous stories. And the one we are going to know more about now. 4.6, The Gift of Magi. Page number 180. Before we start, let us know about the Magi. The Magi, biblical figure, they are considered to be as three wise men, and they were the first one to gift baby Jesus in his manger or crib. And also they are believed to be the one who started the trend of gifting, the gift of the Magi. Is a short story written and published in 1905. It takes place on Christmas Eve and tells the story of Jim and Della Dillingham, a poor young married couple who don't have enough money to buy each other Christmas gifts. Between the couple, Jim's gold pocket watch that once belonged to his father and his grandfather, and Della's lustrous long hair that falls below her knees, are the only two possessions that they consider their treasure. The story begins with the reference of Della, who has only $1.87 in savings with her, and she wanted to buy a gift for her husband, James Dillingham Young, and she had counted all the money she had thrice, but then there was no change in the amount. Now let us see the first paragraph, and it is mentioned here, how did she save that amount? It is by bargaining with grocer, vegetable man, and butcher, until she was blamed of parsimony or frugality, that is an extreme unwillingness to spend money. As she had nothing to do that day, she flopped down on her shabby little couch. In these coming paragraphs, the writer, who is well known for his play of words, has used different words to describe the condition of this young couple. So Della flopped down on the couch, which was shabby, that is in poor condition, and she started to howl, cry. And that instigated, that is provoked or gave rise to the moral reflection that life is made up of three elements or three emotions that is mentioned in the second paragraph, and they are sobs, sniffles and smiles. And sniffles is said to be predominating, that is the strongest element. And Della was still on the first emotion or in the first stage, and as she is gradually subsiding, that is in the third paragraph, subsiding means shifting emotion or becoming less intense in her emotion from first stage to the second stage, that is from sobs to sniffles. Sniffles is a noisy breath. And the writer, in the meanwhile, describes to us the condition of the flat, through which we also come to know about the condition of this young couple, Della and Jim. So we come to know about the rent of the flat, that is $8 per week. And according to the writer, it is not exactly beggar description. It was not impossible to find words to describe the condition of Jim and Della. However, all the words amounted to the same thing. That is something only fit for poor people or beggars. That is why the writer says that it had the word on the lookout for the medicancy squad. That is, it looked like that they were really poor. Medicancy squad, it means police who arrested beggars and homeless people that time. Other descriptions are the letterbox, which is said to be in the vestibule, that is the entrance hall, and the electric button, and both are out of order, not working. And also there is a card bearing the name Mr. James Dillingham Young, and they are said to be prosperous once upon a time, that is during a former period of prosperity. And that time they used to pay $30 per week to the possessor of the house, and now in the present time their income, it was shrunk to $20, and that is why they were thinking to shrink their name card as well from Dillingham to a modest, to a humble D. That is the letter capital D. So again, the writer has played with the word shrink, and that is how we come to know about the financial condition of this young couple. But then also through the last lines, we realize that both Jim and Della were happy. It didn't matter to them the name card or shrinking of the name card, because whenever Mr. James Dillingham came home, reached his flat and he was called Jim and greatly hugged by his wife, Della. And this was all good for them. Page number 181. Della, after she had finished her cry, she applied powder to her cheeks and she stood by the window and started to look out. And what did she see as she was looking out? A gray cat, a gray fence in a gray backyard. Now here the writer has played with word gray in order to show the dullness and sadness that Della is going through using the word gray. And Della was thinking about the amount she had and also the gift that she wanted to buy for her husband. And she wanted the best for him, along with the qualities of being fine, rare, and sterling. Something just a little bit near to being worthy of the honor of being owned by her husband, as he also had these three qualities, that is, of being fine, rare, and sterling. And now in the second paragraph, we come to know about the glass or the mirror that they had in their house. It was a pure glass that is between the windows of the room, and it could be seen, according to the writer, in an $8 flat, as they were financially not very well to do, and that is why. Again, it is a description for us to realize their financial condition. So Della, as she was looking out of the window, suddenly she whirled from the window and stood before the glass. There must be some idea flashed in her mind, and that is why she whirled, that is, twisted and turned around from the window, started to look her reflection in the mirror. And as she was looking at herself, her eyes were shining brilliantly. That was the effect of the idea. But her face had lost its color within 20 seconds. Again, it was the effect of the idea that flashed in her mind, that her face lost its color. And she pulled down her hair and let it fall to its full length. And she was checking her hair, the length, the texture. And now the writer talks about the two possessions that they had or they owned. The James Dillingham Young, in which they both took a mighty pride. The possessions, one was Jim's gold watch that had been his father's and his grandfather's, and the other was Della's hair. Now, prized possession, something you care for deeply above all else, and this is what they did. They did, and the writer has compared their possessions to that of Queen of Sheba and King Solomon. It is mentioned here that if Queen of Sheba lived in the flat across, Della would have let her hair hang out the window in order to show off, so that it would depreciate Sheba's jewels and gifts. And that is how valuable, how precious her hair was, more than all the jewels and gifts of Queen Sheba. And also, if King Solomon had been the janitor of the building, that is caretaker, with all his treasures piled up in the basement, Jim would have pulled out his watch every time he passed, just to make him jealous. So this is two show that how valuable their prized possessions were. Now, Della's beautiful hair fell about her, rippling and shining like a waterfall. The word cascade has been used here in the last paragraph, that is for Della's hair of brown waters, and it reached below her knee, the length, and she did it, and it made her itself like a garment for Della because of the length. And then she did it up again, nervously and quickly, and again she did it nervously and quickly because of the idea she had in her mind. Once she hesitated, but then she made her mind. After, there was a tear or two splashed on the red carpet, and the red carpet, it was worn. Again, this is the description for us to know their financial condition. And then she started to get ready with her brown jacket and brown hat, and both were old. Old is a word used to show their financial condition. And then she gets ready to go out. Page number 182. So Della, with sparkle still in her eyes, she fluttered out her door, down to the stairs to the street. Fluttered, that is moved quickly in random manner. And where she reached, she stopped at the sign which read Marzia Sofroni. That is a title or form of address used instead of Mr., Sir, Madam. So it was Madam Sofroni. And what did it read the sign there? Hair, goods of all kinds. So it dealt in the shop. All kinds of accessories meant for hair. And Della stopped there. And how did she stop? By collecting herself and panting because of the movement that she was walking with. And she asked Sofroni whether she would buy her hair. And Madame Sofroni bought her hair for $20. And Della agreed to that. Now, in the next paragraph, it is mentioned that the next 2 hours tripped by on rosy wings. Time passed really quickly. And what was the reason? As Della, who already had through the first two stages of emotions, that is sobbing, sobs and sniffles, and she was in the third stage, smile. Everything was joyous and happy for her, and that is the reason time passed so quickly for her. And she started to ransack the stores for Jim's present, started to search for Jim's present. And at last, she found a platinum fob chain to replace the old leather strap attached to Jim's watch, which was his prized possession. It was simple and elegant, and it costed $21. And Della was able to pay that amount, as she was given $20 for her hair, and she already had $1.87 with her. So that is how she was able to pay for that platinum fob chain as a gift for her husband. Once Della had returned home, she used curling irons to give herself a new hairdo. Now, the paragraph, in this paragraph, the writer says, the second last paragraph, the writer says, when Stella reached home, her intoxication gave way a little to prudence and reason. So what mental state Della reached home? She was really happy, joyous, and it is said to be a kind of intoxication. That is, it means a state of unconsciousness. She was lost in her own world of happiness, and that's why she gave way a little, that is a little way or almost no way, to wisdom and reason. Prudence, it means wisdom. Now there is a meaning behind this line, why the writer has said so, as she was under the influence of happiness, and that is why she was not able to think wisely. And this is because of whatever she did with her hair. She got it cut and she sold her hair, and that is why she didn't have wisdom when she was under the state of extreme happiness, joy, thinking about her husband. And she got out her iron rods and she started to heat that. And then the writer says the gas, she lighted the gas and went to work repairing the ravages, that is the ruins. And what kind of ruins or what kind of ravages was there? That was made by generosity added to love. So what kind of ruin the writer talks about? That her haircut, whatever she did with her hair, that is said to be as ravage or ruin that she made, and that was the effect of her generosity and love for her husband. And this repairing of the ruins is always a tremendous task, a very great, a huge, a mammoth task, according to the writer. And within 40 minutes, her head was covered with curls. And how did she look like? Like a truant schoolboy. This is a comparison. And a truant means a student who bunks or who stays away from school without leave or permission. And she looked at her reflection in the mirror. And the manner she looked was long, carefully, and critically. And why so? She was thinking about Jim's reaction, whether she would like or no, whether Jim would like the haircut, or he would think that she looked like a Coney Island chorus girl, that is the girls who perform in a chorus and are not so good looking, and that was because of her haircut. It was 7 o'clock and the coffee was prepared and the frying pan was ready to cook the chops, and it was time for Jim to come back, and he was never late. And Della was also ready with the fork chain in her hand and sat on the corner of the table near the door from where he would enter. And then she heard his step on the stair. And she turned white just for a moment. She turned white, that in a kind of fear. And we already know what kind of fear did she have. And out of fear, she started to whisper a prayer. But she already had habit of saying prayer, little silent prayer about the simplest everyday things, and that is why at that time she started to whisper. And what did she say in her prayer? Please God, make him think I'm still pretty. So what was the fear that she had? Not being accepted by Jim in her new haircut. And the door opened, Jim stepped in and closed it. And the description of Jim, that he looked thin and very serious, and he was also said to be as a poor fellow, as he was only 22 and he was burdened with a family and he needed a new overcoat and gloves. Jim stopped inside the door, and as he had a look on Della, he was as immovable as a setter at the scent of a quail. He has been compared by a dog who is immovable looking, at the scent of a bird, the same way Jim was looking at Della's new look. His eyes were fixed upon Della, and there was an expression that Della could not figure out. Della had thought of all kind of reactions, but it was totally different. It was not of anger, surprise, disapproval, horror, or not any kind of sentiments that she had expected or had been prepared for. He simply stared at her fixedly, and that peculiar expression on his face, it was something out of Della's understanding. Della turned off from the table and went towards him, and she cried, "Jim, don't look at me the way you're looking." And she gave excuse for her haircut. Actually, she let him know the reason for her haircut, and she said that she had her hair cut off and sold because she could not have lived through Christmas without giving him a gift. And then she added, her hair will grow out again as it grows awfully fast. And she wanted Jim to be merry, to be happy, and wanted him to wish Merry Christmas. And also, she wanted Jim to see his gift that was brought by her. But Jim was not listening to all this. And his question was, "You have cut off your hair?" And the manner he asked, it is said to be as laboriously, as if he had not arrived at the patent fact yet, even after the hardest mental labor. Even after trying so hard, Jim was not able to believe whatever he was seeing, that is said to be as patent fact, that is a clear and obvious fact. And what was that fact? Della with short hair. And Della said, "Yes, I cut it off and sold it." And then she asked whether he didn't like her in her new hairstyle. She said that she was without her hair. Whether Jim liked her the same way he used to like with her long hair or no. And Jim looked about the room curiously, as if he was searching for something. The next page, 184, and in the first two paragraphs, Della tries to convince Jim about her hair that grows really fast, awfully fast. And also she says that maybe the hairs of my head were numbered, but nobody could ever count my love for you. And this is how she convinced Jim, by saying that it doesn't matter where the hair is same or no, but the love is still the same. Asks whether she could start with frying or cooking the chops. And Jim seemed bewildered a moment later, after he snapped out of his trance. Now, what is meant by trance? That is a state of half consciousness. And it is very clear that he was unconscious, or He was not fully conscious because of whatever happened to him, whatever he saw after reaching home. But after so much of explanation, he was out of his trance and he seemed quickly to wake. And he drew a packet from his overcoat pocket and threw it upon the table. And before that, in the third paragraph, the writer has mentioned the Magi. And he starts with asking a question. And the question is, $8 a week or $1 million a year? What is the difference? Is there any difference? A mathematician or a wit would give you the wrong answer. The Magi. Yes, they brought valuable gifts, but that was not among them. This dark assertion will be illuminated later on. So now, the writer has left us thinking about gifts, about valuable gifts, and also about the art of gifting. The Magi, again, three wise men, biblical figures have been mentioned, and they are very important, as the title of the chapter bears their title. So now let's come back to the packet that Jim had brought for Della. And then Jim says Della not to make mistake again. Any more mistake, such as what she had recently done just for him. For he would still love Della for the same, whatever she is. However, he explained that Della would understand the reason why he reacted strangely upon seeing her earlier after she unwraps her gift. So what do we come to know? That the reaction, whatever Jim had on his face, it was not because of Della's appearance at all. And it was related to the gift that Jim had brought for Della. So, after opening the present, she cried out with joy and then bursted into tears. And what was the reason for that? It was a set of expensive, fancy combs. The same set of combs she had been waiting for a long time. She always craved for, wished for, to own, to possess, but she already and she always knew she could never own those set of combs. Those combs were expensive and simply wonderful that she always wanted to own, with pure tortoise shell and jeweled edges. But then she didn't have the same beautiful long hair to use those combs. Now in the paragraph, second last paragraph, there is a beautiful description that is that a quick feminine change to hysterical tears and wails. That was the change from an ecstatic scream, a joyous scream, to tears and cry, necessitating the immediate employment of all the comforting powers of the Lord of the flat. And what did she need? And what that cry needed that time? The immediate employment of all the comforts or comforting powers of Jim, who is lord of the flat. Then Della gave him his present, holding out the dull, precious metal eagerly. And now let's see Jim's reaction. Page number 185. And Della asked Jim whether it was trendy. And what kind of question it is? It is a rhetorical question. We all know it was already dandy or trendy. And she continued that she hunted, that is, searched all over town to find it for Jim. And she now wanted watch from Jim so that she could see how it looked on it. And instead of obeying, Jim tumbled down on the couch. Tumbled down. We already came across this word in the poem, The Height of the Ridiculous. Students, I hope you all remember the meaning. So what happened to Jim? He fell down on the couch and he put his hands under the back of his head with a smile, and he asked Della to keep their presents for a while aside, explaining that he had sold his watch to buy Della her fancy goals. So this is what Jim did. He says about the gifts, they are too nice to use just at present. And he wanted Della to start cooking the chops. And now we have reached towards the end of the chapter. That is the last paragraph. The writer already had mentioned about the Magi, and it will be illuminated later. The Magi, as you know, they were wise men, wonderfully wise men, and they brought gifts to the baby, that is baby Jesus, in his manger crib. And they were the first one to invent the art of giving, or the art of gifting Christmas presents. And being wise, their gifts were no doubt wise, but also bearing the privilege of exchange in case of duplication. And that is how wise they were. And here I have lamely related to you, that is, the writer is considering himself lamely, that is, inadequately related to you, that is Jim and Della, the uneventful chronicle of two foolish children. So who are these two foolish children, Jim and Della? In this paragraph, the writer is talking to us, the readers, and saying that he lamely related to us the uneventful chronicle of two foolish children, Jim and Della, in a flat, who most unwisely sacrificed. And what manner? Because they are foolish and they sacrificed for each other. So the manner they sacrificed is said to be as unwisely by the writer. And they sacrificed what? Their greatest treasure. But in a last word to the wise of these days, let it be said that of all who give gifts, these two were the wisest. And then the writer concludes, after stating them foolish and unwise, that is Jim and Della, the writer states that out of all who give gifts, these two were the wisest. Oh, of all who give and receive gifts, such as they are wisest. Of all who give gifts and receive gifts, Jim and Della are the wisest. Everywhere they are wisest, they are the Magi. So this is how the story ends. Now, where is the climax of the story? where Jim and Della found out that they sold their prized possessions in order to buy present for each other. And not the last paragraph. Characters of the story are Della and Jim. Genre or category, it is a short story, can be also said as a dramatic irony. Now, what kind of irony is there in this story? The irony is the unexpected outcome of the story. Clearly, Della could not make use of the decorative or expensive combs in her very short hair, and Jim lacks the watch he had sold. And he had no need for the expensive chain or fob chain Della purchased with the sale of her long locks. So this is the irony. It can also be called as parable. That is a simple short story used to illustrate a moral or spiritual lesson. Now, what is the lesson or moral of the story? That is, selflessness and love are the greatest gifts of all. Theme, sacrifice, and setting is flat of Della and Jim. Place and time is Christmas Eve, early 1900 in New York. We have come across the word prized possessions. It is the biggest thing in your life, the one thing you couldn't imagine your life without, something you care for deeply above all else. It could be anything you cherish close to your own heart and can be worth millions or worth nothing to someone else. So that depends. Selflessness and love are the greatest gifts of textual questions. The difficult ones have been done for you, and the other questions, students, you are supposed to write as practice in your English workbook after every chapter is completed. You can take the screenshot better if you write in your notebook. The most prized possessions in life are free, which are love, laughter, and joy. Nothing's really a prized possession except my family, you know. How many of you agree with this? Always remember, students, you are a prized possession of God. And that is why don't forget to take care of yourself. Thank you.